Hey, Rejoice, you got to record it too, right?
Yep. I think we're live in just...
Oh, I know.
Bruce, I need you to shake your butt. I need 30 seconds of Bruce-ness. Tap into those college days, baby.
A show that's just about everything that you can maybe think about, everything that you can feel that's inside of your heart. What I need for you to do right now is spend the next hour relaxing, just stop your day before you go into 12 o'clock. I just want you all to close your minds, open your hearts, and relax and go on this journey with me. It's a beautiful place that you're about to go. Cause I want to make you feel, I want to just open you up and think about some things you never really thought about. Right now. The Wolfkeeper.
Come on!
Good morning, y'all. Come on. It's the Wolfkeeper Show. Get ready. Come on, let's go.
Yeah.
Yeah. Come on.
Yeah. The Wolfkeeper Show. Oh. Your boy.
Toriano Sanzoni. That's me. We got Bruce in the house today. Good morning, Tori Allen Sanzoni here on the Wolfkeeper Show, and I have the fabulous Brucey Bruce. How you doing, brother?
Hey, great, Tori Allen. Good morning.
Man, thank you for participating. Thank you for being amazing. Thank you for being here today. You could be anywhere in the world, but you chose to rock with us, so we appreciate that. Thank you so much.
Thanks for having me today.
Absolutely. Let's just jump right into it. Tell us about your company, Urban. I just totally zoned out.
Alpine Outfitters.
I love that. I don't know why I zoned out, Nick. It's like when I talk about your company, I love that word, Alpiners. It's so manly. Alpine. I'm an Alpiner. So tell us about your company, Urban Alpiners.
Okay, Alpine Outfitters. We started in 1988.
Okay.
We have been in business for over 31 years now.
Oh, wow.
And, 33 years, actually. And we manufacture gear for working and active dogs.
Wow.
So it's, we started off as an actual mushing company. So it's for you know, dog mushing on sleds or on dry land, on carts and scooters. But as we fan up that, still the primary core of our business. But we have customers now who it's expanded to hiking, and ski joring,
nice.
Bike joring, running, canicross, which is the form of racing with your dog.
Nice.
All kinds of great dog-powered activities. So it's the full spectrum now, and it's everything that we do is about doing something with your dog and dog-powered sports.
Dog-powered
sports. It's just a really fun way to make a living, and a fun way to meet customers literally all over the world. We sell internationally.
Wow.
And, it's really, really wonderful.
Now, Bruce, let me interrupt for a second. Rejoice, can we go back to that picture prior to with the dogs mushing? So I just got to say this because I know people all around the world and I've been doing this for 20 years. Is this safe for dogs to do this? Is it humane? Because I know I don't want anyone out there seeing this and be like, this is evil. This is terrible.
It's very safe, very humane. Bottom line is the dogs love it.
Okay.
So, like with any sport, you train and you condition, and you condition your dogs, you condition yourself, and use the proper equipment. But keep in mind, these dogs are bred, it's in their DNA.
Okay.
Not only to run, but to pull.
So not only to run, but to pull.
Some degree Siberian Husky in their mix, and that's what they were bred for.
That's a new fun fact. You just said most dogs have some breed of Siberian Husky.
I'm saying dogs that are used for mushing.
Oh, dogs are used for mushing. Okay, not
yeah,
just
so,
okay.
Yeah, exactly. And the reason for that is for the
their biological development to withstand cold weather and run long distances and to pull, because that's what they were actually bred for. And they were bred to be working dogs and to pull the Chukchi Indians in Siberia to pull their villages from place to place during hunting seasons. They
wow.
load everybody up in a sled and they go to the next hunting place. And so these dogs were actually bred to run long distances and to pull weight.
Well, that's some super interesting fact. I would love to, I have this vision, Bruce, one day that dog training and dog psychology will be an actual major in all colleges around the world. So, I mean, and also incorporated in school. But how interesting is that? That's a fun fact for kids to learn. I mean, I would encourage people then to potentially even teach your kids about mushing. That's a super
good idea. Yeah, exactly. And it really goes back to your question of, is it safe? And so it's what they're bred to do. So you let them do what they're bred for. But it's also fun. They love it. And if you ever get a chance to see, you can see it in that picture that you showed there, the look on the dog's faces. But when they're ready to go, they are jumping and pulling in their harnesses and crying and howling and everything because they want to go. They want to run. As soon as they take off, they're happy. You see smiles on their faces and they're running.
Now,
and,
Bruce, here, fun fact. So a sleigh team, two questions. How many dogs does that typically consume of and then consist of? And then – secondly, how fast can they go?
Yeah, so again, mushing is, it means a lot of different things.
Okay.
And so there's like the team that you just saw was a 12-dog team.
Okay.
And they were running up in Wyoming. They were running 35 miles a day for 6 days.
Wow, 35 miles a day for 6 days?
For 6 days, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, day after day after day. The Iditarod race is almost 1,100 miles.
1,100 miles?
Yeah, and they'll
Bruce, shut the front door.
In 11 days.
1,100 miles, a team of dogs. Right.
Yeah.
So how many hours per day?
Well, it'll vary. So they'll run 6 to 8 hours a day.
Wow.
In the Iditarod race, they actually have scheduled rest stops and everything else. Having said that, they'll still run 1,100 miles in anywhere from 8 to 11 days now.
Wowzers, that's so amazing.
100 miles a day.
That's so amazing. I'm sure, I mean, as a dog professional, I always tell people one of the biggest things that we do with transformation of the animal is cardio.
Sure.
And because most dogs just aren't getting enough cardio. So you're saying a dog is running 5 to 6 hours per day for, I mean, that's just for that particular race. I think that's just so freaking awesome, amazing. What particular breeds are you using? In that picture that you showed us, there seemed to be a lot of different breeds. Were those specific breeds, or were those like just good old?
Those are Alaskan Huskies, and Alaskan Huskies are actually well-bred mutts. So
gotcha.
Most of them have Siberian Husky at their base.
Okay.
So to help withstand cold weather and endurance and so on.
Okay.
But then they breed in like German Short Hair Pointer.
Really?
Funky, you know, different dogs for speed. And that's where the race part comes in.
Gotcha.
So, Siberian Huskies. And Siberian Huskies, they're an amazing breed. They're the original, but they're also slower. They call them Slowberians up in the races. They
gotcha.
Can go a long distance and withstand the cold weather better than any other breed, but they're not as fast for the races. So they'll take the Siberian Husky as a base, and then they'll breed in other types of breeds that have more speed. And so that's what you see there. So they're very well-bred mutts, we always say. But,
so let me ask you this, just because
yeah.
this just went through my mind. So this is another, because I love, you know, educating people too, especially people that are super sensitive towards dog rights. I know it because my dogs, I mean, like right now, there was tons of snow in Chicago. They're laying down in the snow, like literally like it's a warm carpet. These dogs love the snow, correct? They like
they love the snow. Our dogs?
Yeah.
Oh,
so how is that? Because sometimes people think that it's cruel that a dog's outside in the snow and they sleep in the snow. Because I know too that I knew some people a long time ago, like in Alaska, in those parts where these huskies were outside, in the snow like a lot. So like, how is that just from a dog psychology, like an animal point of view of like how they're cool with those kind of temperatures?
Yeah, no. So again, it depends on the breed, you know. So your northern dogs are actually bred for that. Even with that being said, you know, you see the dogs up in Alaska, they're out in the snow, but they also have dog houses, and they have strong dog houses. Even here in Central Oregon, you know, we have our kennels. We have not nearly as harsh temperatures. They'll drop down to 20 degrees, 15 degrees, and so on. And our dogs have houses. So they go in their houses, and it's all cuddly inside, and that's where they like to be. To bring them into a heated house is actually not good for them.
Really?
You know, they actually don't like that, yeah. So if they could stay outside, they stay outside. Our dogs, we have nine, they do sleep in the house at night. They all have a bed.
Okay.
So our dogs are kind of spoiled. But going back to the dogs in Alaska, I mean, it's what they're bred for. They're bred for cold weather. They prefer to be outside. You'll see them snuggle under the snow, dig under, and be really comfortable there. You know?
Right.
To bring them into a heated house is actually not good for them.
And I love that from a dog psychology point of view, because I remember someone telling me that they saw these dogs that had basically made themselves like little donuts and like basically were using the snow like their
exactly.
own incubation. I mean, it's so – I think I just – that's the part I love about dog training and breed, different breeds, because there's certain breeds that are out there that embrace
yeah.
that cold and are built for that cold.
Well, they are. And even the big fluffy tails on a husky, when they lay down in the snow or even if they lay down on the bed inside the house, just instinct, go ahead and curl around like a dog does, and then that fluffy tail will go over their nose.
Wow.
But over there when they're laying there sleeping, breathing.
Wow! Never even thought about that.
Huskies, the way they're built, is just amazing. Right down to their blood vessels are all deep inside the muscle to prevent heat loss. So they're just different, and that's down to their feet too. So their feet don't get cold. Huskies quite often don't wear booties. They're on those long races. They're not wearing booties because their feet are actually built for it.
Wow!
Put booties on a husky is to prevent cuts from ice. But otherwise, their feet don't get cold. Whereas some of the other dogs, like the Alaskan Huskies, they have the other mixes in. You'll quite often have to wear booties because their feet get cold, whereas Siberian doesn't. But
wow,
it's just interesting stuff. Yeah, yeah.
That's so awesome, and that's so important too, because all breeds are designed for different things. And I tell
exactly.
people too, Huskies are really tough breeds to own in the city if you're not going to be engaged and super active with them. You know, and you just made me think of some things too. Of like, here's a dog that wants to be in the snow. So if you're in a hot area, that's tough for them. There's a dog that
right.
wants to run. So if you're not a runner,
right.
that's tough for
right.
them. And they're just the endurance. I mean, they're just phenomenal. I mean, they suck as condo dogs, but obviously, you know, you just described some things to me. Here's an animal that wants to be outside most of its time. And I don't think a lot of times people really think about the research we're getting any breed, but especially, you know, a sleigh dog.
Right. No, exactly. See, the thing with a husky, and not just to focus on the husky, but the husky is a pack animal. It likes to be part of the, you know, the pack, which includes the family. So that's why our dogs come in at night, because they want to be in with us. They do want to be there with us, but or with other dogs.
Right.
You know, so to be in a condo with a husky, you know, I always tell people, if you're going to get a husky, you have to be prepared to, one, have space for them and be able to give them the proper exercise. And it's not enough just to go walk 3 miles or 4 miles or even 5 miles. They want to be able to run. And then that second component is the pool. So anyone's thinking about a husky, you want to have to make sure that you want to make sure you're able to give them the proper exercise. And one way to do that, if you have a city dog and you have the right temperatures, right climate, is urban mushing. And there you can get the same experience as pulling a sled,
mm-hmm.
but if you're pulling a scooter or a cart. And here you can run the, you know, areas in Chicago with a two-dog team or a four-dog team or anywhere in the country, if the temperature's cool enough, and still get that same experience. And if you have an active dog, a husky or a husky mix, or other active, I mean, there's a lot of breeds that are just good active, they want to run. We've had dogs run with us that are standard poodles, labs.
Mm.
They don't run as far, but they still get that same experience.
Mm.
They like to work too. They like to do something with you. They can do And then you get a 3 mile run in, everyone has a great time, and they go home and sleep, and they're happy because they did something productive.
Right.
You know? And huskies, the difference is they'll want to run and run and run and run. But even huskies, you have to start off slow. You condition them slowly. Like at the start of every new season, we'll take them on just a 1 mile run.
Mm.
And then get back into it. And then the next day or 3 days later, it's 2 miles. And then 3 miles, and then 4 miles, and then 6 miles, and then 8 miles, and then 10 miles, and so on. But every season, we start them off nice and slow. And same with that team that you saw running in that picture that ran the 35-mile race. They don't start that way.
Mm-hmm.
The season starts nice and slow. And you condition the dogs just like you would yourself if you're going to start jogging.
Right.
Yeah. So.
Bruce, so and kudos to your company because you guys have been around close to over 30 years, correct?
Over 33 years now, yes.
30, that's, so kudos to you. That's a lot of, like, dog knowledge that you have. What would you say it's like, because, you know, now people, there are people that know why they got a husky. You know, they want to run, they're runners, they're active, you know, they're outback type people. What is something that we can encourage people that do have those particular breeds? Why they should get involved with urban mushing, and how do they even go about that? If someone says, hey, you know what? I have a super active dog. I'm a runner. I'm a jogger. Obviously, I don't live in the snow areas, but I would love to do, because I've seen people around here in Chicago out urban mushing.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that's a great question. I'm going to use, just as example, the husky, but this will apply to any active working dog.
Okay.
You know, if it's a heeler, it's a Dalmatian, whatever you have, something, a working dog that wants to run. But we started off with a husky that no matter what we did, the dog parked 7 days a week, took her on long hikes, long runs, she would never get tired. And we said, something's got to change here. And so we Googled, we heard about urban mushing. And this is what I recommend to anyone who has an active dog.
Urban mushing.
Google for your area. Urban mushing.
Okay.
Urban mushing groups. And there's a Facebook group, for example, that they're nationwide. And I've seen people go on there and say, I'm in South Carolina. Is there any urban mushing groups in my area? And all of a sudden, something, yeah, we run. We run every Saturday down here. Anyway, to get a local group really helps. Because then when you start running your dog, let's say you start off with a bike. You don't have a scooter or a sled. Scooter for dry land and sled for snow, of course. But you might start with a bike. But to go running with a group that has dogs too, your dog figures it out real quick.
Mm.
Oh, well, fun. Because I see the other dogs running, and they're all running together.
Mm.
Socialization for the dogs, great socialization for the people, is you make friends. And you all get to do it together, and the dogs really enjoy it. So if you can, I recommend, that's what we did. We found back then in Southern California, a local group. They had about any given time anywhere from 50 to 100 mushers.
Okay.
It was a large group and a lot of dogs, not all at the same time, but to, you know, we all got together different times. And it was really wonderful. And our dogs, and we learned how to mush that way.
Mm-hmm.
And it was really good. And to clarify, our company's been around for 33 years. My wife and I have had it for 11 years.
Okay.
We got it from the founders, 11, they're friends of ours, 11 years ago when they retired.
Okay.
And that's when we started. Right before that, a couple years before, we started mushing with our dog Sasha.
Okay.
And then, but that was so much fun that we had to get a second dog. And then Nico. And next thing, now we've had 11 over the years. Now we have 9 now.
What's all 9's name?
Oh, so we got Chibs, Cindy Lou, Sketcher, Twix, Puzzle, Lucky, Czar, Hannah, and Luke.
Wow. I love
yeah.
that. That's,
yeah.
that's a full crew.
Yeah, we have a full crew. And they range in age from 2.5 years now to 14 years.
Wow, that is such a pleasure. Like having 9 dogs that are your own personal dogs.
They're
in the
all
house,
awesome,
like
too.
you can't even get any more dog ownership, dog love. Bruce, before we go, where's the best place a person can find out more about your company?
AlpineOutfitters.net.
Okay.
AlpineOutfitters.net. And we have a good how to get started section on there too.
Yep.
And you know, and we're always just a phone call away. So we live and breathe dogs. And not just mushing, that's our main sport. Remember, it's hiking, biking, it's ski jumping, canicross, all kinds of great things. So also there's something for every dog.
Oh no, I mean that's so awesome, man. I love the fact that, I mean, this is something that it warms my heart. I love seeing dogs run. I love seeing dogs do things. So
well, you know what? What is really interesting and this year, this past year and this year, one of silver and for many, but one of them is people are actually home more.
Yep.
And they're spending a lot more time with their dogs.
Absolutely.
And we've seen our business just increase dramatically.
I love that.
People who are calling and saying, I want to go hiking with my dog. What do I need? Or I want to take my dog on a bike. Or I want to learn about urban mushing. And we've just seen so many new customers. And all these dogs.
That pumps me up.
We turn on to, it's just wonderful. It's wonderful.
That is so awesome.
And again, that's been a silver lining to it, you know.
And you're helping people too. You're getting people out the house. You help people do cardio because even though we have to social distance, you have your dog. You can still go out there and do things one on one with your dog to be a part
of
it.
Well, yeah, and so the dog, you get to do that and interface with your dog. The dog's getting exercised, but guess who else is getting exercised? The dog's like,
yeah,
you know, and everyone's getting to run and bike and scooter, and it's really good. It's just a good thing all the way around.
That's so awesome.
It's a great way to social distance, too.
Right.
A trail somewhere.
Oh, man. Bruce, I want to thank you so much for coming on our show again. You rocked. It was when I first met you last year, it was so super fabulous. All I did was talk about that everyone, urban mushing. We have two Rottweilers and a Doberman. So I'm like pumped. I'm going to get me some urban mushing gear. But we're going to start.
You have great dogs for that.
Yeah, no. My fiance and I were just talking about doing that, going hiking. We're gonna show some video of urban mushing. I want to bring you back again once we hit the spring. But I want to thank you for real for coming out. Anyone that's watching this, please share this podcast broadcast because it's more than just this company of buying gear for your dog. It's about your health, about the dog's health, about well-being. And wellness, and we find wellness through cardio. It's the oldest relationship between human and animal, running. Because the dogs, if you can't lead, the dogs can't follow. And the best way to establish leadership is through running and cardio, going through those mountains, going hiking. If you don't have a mountain, go in the city of Chicago, New York, and urban mush your animal. That's what I'm saying.
Absolutely.
Check
Absolutely.
Out Bruce. All right, Bruce, thank you so much. We're out of here. Toriano San Antonio, the Wolfkeeper. Thank you to producer Rejoice, the whole Wolfkeeper crew, Tyrone Scott, everybody out there. Big
all right.
I'm out. Peace. Go love somebody. That's a wrap.